Saul's sad final days and death. 28:3-7. Now Samuel had died, and all Israel had mourned for him and buried him in Ramah, his own city. And Saul had removed the mediums and the spiritists, soothsayers, from the land. The Philistines assembled and came and camped at Shunem, and Saul gathered all the Israelites, and they camped at Gilboa. When Saul saw the Philistine army, he was afraid and badly shaken. So Saul inquired of the Lord, but the Lord did not answer him, either by dreams or by Urim, used like lots by the priests to determine the will of God, or by prophets. Then Saul said to his servants, "Find for me a woman who is a medium between the living and the dead, so that I may go to her and ask her advice." His servants said to him, "There is a woman who is a medium at Endor." Saul was in a bad situation as the Philistines prepared to go to war against Israel. He was terrified. But he didn't just have a military problem, he also had a spiritual one. The Lord's prophet Samuel had died. Samuel was a key figure in his life. Samuel anointed him as king. 1 Samuel 12:1-2. Then Samuel addressed all Israel. "I have done as you asked and given you a king. Your king is now your leader. I stand here before you, an old gray-haired man, and my sons serve you. I have served as your leader from the time I was a boy to this very day." Samuel also let him know what the God of Israel wanted. 1 Samuel 15:1-3. One day Samuel said to Saul, "It was the Lord who told me to anoint you as king of his people, Israel. Now listen to this message from the Lord. This is what the Lord of heaven's armies has declared. I have decided to settle accounts with the nation of Amalek for opposing Israel when they came out of Egypt." Now that Samuel was gone, the Lord had refused to respond to Saul's advice requests. Previously, in accordance with Moses' law, Saul had expelled mediums and spiritists from the land. Deuteronomy 18:9-12. "When you enter the land the Lord your God is giving you, do not learn to imitate the detestable ways of the nations there. Let no one be found among you who sacrifices their son or daughter in the fire, who practices divination or sorcery, interprets omens, engages in witchcraft, or casts spells, or who is a medium or spiritist, or who consults the dead. Anyone who does these things is detestable to the Lord. Because of these same detestable practices, the Lord your God will drive out those nations before you." Now, desperate for supernatural guidance, Saul resorted to that which God had clearly prohibited. As king over God's people, he was a complete failure. 1 Samuel 28:8-16. So Saul disguised himself by wearing different clothes, and he left with two men, and they came to the woman at night. He said to her, "Conjure up for me, please, and bring up from the dead for me the spirit whom I shall name to you." But the woman said to him, "See here, you know what Saul has done, how he has cut off, eliminated those who are mediums and spiritists from the land. So why are you laying a trap for my life to cause my death?" Then Saul swore an oath to her by the Lord, saying, "As the Lord lives, no punishment shall come upon you for this." So the woman said, "Whom shall I bring up for you?" He said, "Bring up Samuel for me." When the woman saw Samuel, she screamed with a loud voice, and she said to Saul, "Why have you deceived me? You are Saul." The king said to her, "Do not be afraid, but tell me, what do you see?" The woman said to Saul, "I see a divine, superhuman being coming up from the earth." A medium was someone who communicated with the dead in order to predict the future. Saul was unconcerned about God's law. He was desperate for answers. So he disguised himself and went to a medium to have her consult a spirit for him. The woman was concerned that this was a sting operation because such people had been eradicated in Israel by the king. But Saul assured her that she would be safe. So, as requested, she summoned Samuel from the dead and was astounded as anyone else when the prophet appeared. She immediately recognized her client as King Saul. 1 Samuel 28:14-19. He said to her, "What is his appearance?" And she said, "An old man is coming up, wrapped in a robe." Then Saul knew that it was Samuel, and he bowed with his face to the ground and paid respect to him. Then Samuel said to Saul, "Why have you disturbed me by bringing me up?" Saul answered, "I am greatly distressed, for the Philistines are making war against me, and God has left me and no longer answers me, either through prophets or by dreams. Therefore, I have called you to make known to me what I should do." Samuel said, Why then do you ask me, since the Lord has left you and has become your enemy? The Lord has done to you just as he said through me when I was with you. For the Lord has torn the kingdom out of your hand and given it to your neighbor, to David, because you did not obey the voice of the Lord and did not execute his fierce wrath on Amalek. Therefore, the Lord has done this thing to you this day. Moreover, the Lord will also put Israel along with you into the hands of the Philistines, and tomorrow you and your sons will be with me among the dead. Indeed, the Lord will put the army of Israel into the hands of the Philistines. Rivers of ink have been spilled by commentators arguing whether or not this account was a genuine return of Samuel's spirit from the dead. The text presents it as such, rather than as a demon impersonating Samuel or implying that the medium merely used her wits to deceive Saul. It's unlikely that an impersonator could have fooled Saul, and Samuel's message of judgment on Saul, including his loss of the kingdom to David, his impending death, and Israel's defeat, was exactly what happened. As a result, it appears that God used an otherwise forbidden method to deliver his verdict on a rebellious Saul. When Saul asked Samuel for assistance, claiming that God had abandoned him, Samuel responded, "Of course he has." Saul had disobeyed the Lord's clear instructions, and the Lord had wrenched the throne from Saul's grasp. Then Samuel announced God's final judgment on the house of Saul. "Tomorrow you and your sons will be with me," that is, dead. 1 Samuel 28, 20-25. Then Saul immediately fell full length on the earth floor of the medium's house, and he was very afraid because of Samuel's words, and he was thoroughly exhausted because he had not eaten all day and all night. The woman came to Saul and saw that he was greatly troubled, and she said to him, "Look, your maidservant has obeyed you, and I have taken my life in my hand and have listened to everything you said to me. So now, please listen to the voice of your maidservant, and let me set a piece of bread before you, and eat, so that you may have strength when you go on your way." But he refused and said, "I will not eat." But his servants, together with the woman, urged him, and he finally listened to them. So he got up from the ground and sat on the bed. The woman had a fattened calf in the house. She quickly killed it and took flour, kneaded it, and baked unleavened bread. She brought it before Saul and his servants, and they ate. Then they got up and went away that night. Samuel's words knocked the doomed king to the ground. He was terrified and weak due to a lack of nutrition. Even the medium felt sorry for what had to be a pitiful sight of Israel's king practically fainting in terror. She tried to persuade Saul to eat and eventually persuaded him to do so. Finally, the entourage disbanded and returned to the Israelite camp. It was Saul's final night on earth. 1 Samuel 31, Saul and his sons slain. Now the Philistines fought against Israel, and the men of Israel fled before them and fell slain on Mount Gilboa. The Philistines overtook Saul and his sons, and they killed Jonathan and Abinadab and Malchishua, Saul's sons. The battle went heavily against Saul, and the archers hit him, and he was severely wounded by the archers. The tragic battle prophesied by Samuel in chapter 28 of Samuel between Israel and the Philistines took place on Mount Gilboa. The Philistines targeted Israel's leaders, Saul and his sons, following a common strategy in ancient warfare. Jonathan and two of his brothers were killed, and Saul received serious injuries. Saul was well aware that if the Philistines discovered him alive, he would be subjected to a slow, torturous death. 1 Samuel 31:4-7. Saul said to his armor-bearer, "Draw your sword and pierce me through with it, otherwise these uncircumcised Philistines will come and pierce me through and abuse and mock me." But his armor-bearer would not, because he was terrified of doing such a thing. So Saul took his sword and fell on it. When his armor-bearer saw that Saul was dead, he also fell on his sword and died with him. So Saul, his three sons, his armor-bearer, and all his men died together on that day. When the men of Israel who were on the other side of the valley of Jezreel and those who were beyond the Jordan saw that the other men of Israel had fled and that Saul and his sons were dead, they abandoned the cities and fled. Then the Philistines came and lived in them. To avoid torture, Saul ordered his armor-bearer to run him through with his sword. However, the armor-bearer was too afraid and unwilling to oppose the king, so he refused Saul's command. As a result, Saul was killed by his own sword. When the men of Israel on both sides of the Jordan River saw that Saul was dead, they fled in panic and abandoned some cities completely, allowing the Philistines to settle in them. 1 Samuel 31:8-10. The next day, when the Philistines came to plunder the dead, they found Saul and his three sons fallen on Mount Gilboa. So they cut off Saul's head and stripped off his weapons and armor and sent them throughout the land of the Philistines to bring the good news to the house of their idols and to the people. And they put Saul's weapons and armor in the temple of the Ashtaroth, female goddesses, and they fastened his body to the wall of Beth Shan. The fact that the Philistines couldn't torture and display Saul as a trophy while he was still alive didn't stop them from disgracing his body. They beheaded him, pinned his body to a wall near Gilboa, and buried his armor in the temple of their gods as a symbol of their deity's power over the Lord. Saul's disobedience to God and complete spiritual collapse ended tragically, not only for him and his family, but also for the people of Israel, who insisted on having him as their king despite God's warnings. Their king had died, his family had been decimated, Israel's army had been scattered, and the nation had lost some of its territory. Worst of all, the Lord's name had been desecrated. Importantly, Saul could still have received God's blessing if he had chosen to obey the Lord wholeheartedly. However, Saul's half-hearted attitude toward God's commands, as well as his proclivity to excuse himself and blame others, revealed character flaws that God knew would disqualify him as king. The author of 1 Chronicles clearly summarized the reason for Saul's death. 1 Chronicles 10:13 and 14. Saul died because he was unfaithful to the Lord. He did not keep the word of the Lord and even consulted a medium for guidance and did not inquire of the Lord. So the Lord put him to death and turned the kingdom over to David, son of Jesse. 1 Samuel 31:11-13. When the inhabitants of Jabesh-Gilead heard what the Philistines had done to Saul, all the brave men stood and walked all night. And they took the bodies of Saul and his sons from the wall of Beth-shan, and they came to Jabesh and cremated them there. They took their bones and buried them under the tamarisk tree at Jabesh, and fasted as a sign of mourning and respect for 7 days. The people of Jabesh-Gilead had been rescued from the Ammonites by Saul many years earlier. 1 Samuel 11:1-11. Nahash the Ammonite went up and besieged Jabesh-Gilead, and all the men of Jabesh said to him, "Make a treaty with us, and we will be subject to you." But Nahash the Ammonite replied, "I will make a treaty with you only on the condition that I gouge out the right eye of every one of you, and so bring disgrace on all Israel." The elders of Jabesh said to him, "Give us 7 days so we can send messengers throughout Israel. If no one comes to rescue us, we will surrender to you." When the messengers came to Gibeah of Saul and reported these terms to the people, they all wept aloud. Just then Saul was returning from the fields behind his oxen, and he asked, "What is wrong with everyone? Why are they weeping?" Then they repeated to him what the men of Jabesh had said. When Saul heard their words, the Spirit of God came powerfully upon him, and he burned with anger. He took a pair of oxen, cut them into pieces, and sent the pieces by messengers throughout Israel, proclaiming, "This is what will be done to the oxen of anyone who does not follow Saul and Samuel." Then the terror of the Lord fell on the people, and they came out together as one. When Saul mustered them at Bezek, the men of Israel numbered 300,000, and those of Judah 30,000. They told the messengers who had come, "Say to the men of Jabesh-Gilead, by the time the sun is hot tomorrow, you will be rescued." When the messengers went and reported this to the men of Jabesh, they were elated. They said to the Ammonites, "Tomorrow we will surrender to you, and you can do to us whatever you like." The next day, Saul separated his men into three divisions. During the last watch of the night, they broke into the camp of the Ammonites and slaughtered them until the heat of the day. Those who survived were scattered so that no two of them were left together. And here they showed their gratitude. Their brave men made a perilous all-night journey to Beth Shan to recover and properly dispose of the bodies of Saul and his sons. The people of Jabesh buried their dead and fasted for 7 days in memory of Saul and his sons. This fast was a genuine expression of their grief. All of Israel has a right to be a part of it. King Saul's sin and rejection of the Lord's will had brought the entire kingdom to ruin and shame. The nation had reached a low point from which only God could deliver it. As it turned out, he was more than willing to do so through another king, one who was a man after his own heart. David hears of Saul's death. After the death of Saul, David returned from striking down the Amalekites and stayed at Ziklag 2 days. On the third day, a man arrived from Saul's camp with his clothes torn and dust on his head. When he came to David, he fell to the ground to pay him honor. "Where have you come from?" David asked him. He answered, I have escaped from the Israelite camp. What happened? David asked. Tell me. The men fled from the battle, he replied. Many of them fell and died, and Saul and his son Jonathan are dead. Then David said to the young man who brought him the report, How do you know that Saul and his son Jonathan are dead? I happened to be on Mount Gilboa, the young man said, and there was Saul leaning on his spear with the chariots and their drivers in hot pursuit. When he turned around and saw me, he called out to me, and I said, What can I do? He asked me, Who are you? An Amalekite, I answered. Then he said to me, Stand here by me and kill me. I'm in the throes of death, but I'm still alive. So I stood beside him and killed him, because I knew that after he had fallen, he could not survive. And I took the crown that was on his head and the band on his arm and have brought them here to my lord. Then David and all the men with him took hold of their clothes and tore them. They mourned and wept and fasted till evening for Saul and his son Jonathan and for the army of the Lord and for the nation of Israel, because they had fallen by the sword. David said to the young man who brought him the report, Where are you from? I am the son of a foreigner, an Amalekite, he answered. David asked him, Why weren't you afraid to lift your hand to destroy the Lord's anointed? Then David called one of his men and said, Go, strike him down. So he struck him down and he died. For David had said to him, Your blood be on your own head. Your own mouth testified against you when you said, I killed the Lord's anointed. David's lament for Saul and Jonathan. David took up this lament concerning Saul and his son Jonathan, and he ordered that the people of Judah be taught this lament of the bow. It is written in the book of Jashar. A gazelle lies slain on your heights, Israel. How the mighty have fallen. Tell it not in Gath, proclaim it not in the streets of Ashkelon, lest the daughters of the Philistines be glad, lest the daughters of the uncircumcised rejoice. Mountains of Gilboa, may you have neither dew nor rain, may no showers fall on your terraced fields. For there the shield of the mighty was despised, the shield of Saul no longer rubbed with oil. From the blood of the slain, from the flesh of the mighty, the bow of Jonathan did not turn back, the sword of Saul did not return unsatisfied. Saul and Jonathan, in life they were loved and admired, and in death they were not parted. They were swifter than eagles, they were stronger than lions. Daughters of Israel, weep for Saul, who clothed you in scarlet and finery, who adorned your garments with ornaments of gold. How the mighty have fallen in battle. Jonathan lies slain on your heights. I grieve for you, Jonathan, my brother. You were very dear to me. Your love for me was wonderful, more wonderful than that of women. How the mighty have fallen. The weapons of war have perished.